Sometimes the moon sat in the well at night, and when I stirred it with a stick, it broke. If I kept stirring, it swirled like white water, as if water were light, and the stick a wand that made the light follow, then slow into water again, unwobbling until the wind moved it. And I thought of all the moons, floating in the wells and rivers, spilling over rocks where the water broke. Moons in the sheep water, in the chicken water, or here or there an oar bent it, or a woman spread out her skirt and let it pool there, the light, I mean, not the moon in a circle, not the moon itself, but the light that fell from it.
Theopoetics is an emphasis, a style, or a positive concern for the intersection of theology or spirituality with the imagination, aesthetics, the arts, and embodiment, especially as it takes shape in ways that engender community and affirming dialogue and transformation. Inadvertently, we've defined Marie's work, I think. I'm hard-pressed to think of poems that gather us as readers, as people, and gather us into a deeper appreciation of experience than Marie's. Her poems are concerned with smallness, with the mundane, with the typicality of our experience, with the objects, the places, and the people gathered into the hidden wholeness she articulates in her work.
I was embarrassed to write about theological themes. When I first began to write, I tried to write away from them. But these questions have concerned me since my whole life, as I'm sure they concern you. Who are we? Where did we come from? Where are we going? How do we make meaning out of our life? How do we deal with our fear, with our love, with our desire, with our anxiety? How do we deal with the fact that we're alive and that we're going to die? Poetry was the place that I went to that began to speak to those questions in a way that didn't have answers, but had companionship. And could hold the questions themselves without having to resolve them into dogma. I was also longing, I grew up as a Catholic girl, but I really wanted to be Jewish because the Jewish people could do midrash, which was imagining themselves into the stories of the Torah. Imagining what happened the day after Adam and Eve were told to leave paradise. Imagining what it was like for Cain's mother after he was dead. I realized only gradually that this also was possible in poetry. So the silent places in the well-known stories became fecund. Became compelling. So I want to start with a very short poem called Part of Eve's Discussion, where Eve is describing what a certain moment in her life was like. You all remember Eve. When we open our MacBooks, you know what pops up, right? Apple.
Yes.
It's amazing. It's right there, the fall of humankind. Every time we open our computer, there it is, the apple with a bite out of it that caused all this trouble. Part of Eve's discussion. It was like the moment when a bird decides not to eat from your hand and flies, just before it flies. The moment the rivers seem to still and stop because a storm is coming, but there is no storm. It's when 100 starlings lift and bank together before they wheel and drop, very much like the moment driving on bad ice, when it occurs to you your car could spin just before it slowly begins to spin, like the moment just before you forgot what it was you were about to say. It was like that. And after that, it was still like that, only all the time. Um, My first book was called The Good Thief. You guys might actually know who The Good Thief is. Derek Walcott used to teach at BU. And Derek, should I tell you a little dirty story? Not about Derek, but about The Good Thief. Maybe I shouldn't. I don't know. Uh-oh. Just backed myself into something. He told me to keep that title. The second book is called What the Living Do. And the center of this book is really concerns my brother John, who died in the late 80s after living with AIDS for 2 years. So I want to just read a couple of poems with Johnny in them. Johnny was 11 years younger than I. I come from a very large family. There were 9 children in my family of origin. And John, but he was my spiritual teacher in many, many ways. The first poem is called For 3 Days. And it refers to those 3 days when Lazarus died, remember? And Mary and Martha sent for Jesus, and he kept saying, I'll be there in a minute, I'll be there. And he arrived too late. My brother John actually did die and came back from the dead and went on to live 2 more years. And so this is about that time when I was driving toward him, when he was suddenly very sick, then on a ventilator, then dying for 3 days. For 3 days now, I've been trying to think of another word for gratitude. Because my brother could have died and didn't. Because for a week, we stood in the intensive care, trying not to imagine how it would be then afterwards. My youngest brother, Andy, said, "This is so weird. I don't know if I'll be talking with John today or buying a pair of pants for his funeral." And I hated him for saying it, because it was true. It seemed to tilt it, because I had been writing his elegy in my head during the 7-hour drive there and trying not to. Thinking meant not thinking. It meant imagining my brother surrounded by light, like Schrodinger's cat that would be dead if you looked and might live if you didn't. And then it got better, and then it got worse. And it's a story now. He came back. And I did, by that time, imagine him dead. And I did begin to write the other story, how the crowd in the stifling church snapped to a tearful attention, how my brother lived again for a few minutes through me. And although I know I couldn't help it, because fear has its own language, and its own story, because even grief provides a living remedy. I can't help but think of that woman who said to him whom she considered her savior, "If thou hadst been here, my brother had not died." How she might have practiced her speech, and how she too might have stood trembling and unable to meet the eyes of the dear familiar figure that stumbled from the cave when the compassionate fist of God opened and crushed her with gratitude and shame. Back in the 80s, it was a very homophobic time. Thank goodness it's mostly over. And Jesse Helms passed an amendment saying that no work that had homoerotic content could be given a National Endowment for the Arts Award. Mm-hmm. He did that. It passed. So I wrote a little homoerotic poem in the broadest sense of the word, because what does that really mean, homoerotic? What is eros, right? So it's called Just Now. My brother's name is John, and his beloved is Joe. They lived together until John died. My brother opens his eyes when he hears the door click open downstairs and Joe's steps walking up past the meowing cat. And the second click of the upstairs door. And then he lifts his face so that Joe can kiss him. Joe has brought armfuls of broken magnolia branches in full blossom, and he putters in the kitchen looking for a big jar to put them in and finds it. And now they tower in the living room, white and sweet, where John can see them if he leans out from his bed, which he can't do just now. And now Joe is cleaning. "What a mess you've left me," he says. And John is smiling, almost asleep again. Does anybody here have a phobia? What's yours?
Water I can't see through.
Water you can't see through. Who else has that phobia? See, you have company. Who else? What other phobias? What's your?
Ships.
Ships?
Yep.
Boats?
The big ones.
Ocean liners.
Yeah.
Okay. No. I have so many phobias, I would never. Anybody else? Who's got a weirder one? Ships? What do you got?
Mannequins.
Somebody here?
Mayonnaise.
What?
Mayonnaise.
Mayonnaise. That's a good one. Somebody else, one last one. Yeah.
Textured circle patterns, like honeycombs and things. Like
oh yeah, that. I understand. Did you hear him?
No.
Textured circle patterns. He gets intricate. Textured circle, I get it. Well, my brother had a phobia, and this is about that, and it's a guess about mine too. It's called How Some of It Happened. My brother was afraid, even as a boy, of going blind. So deeply, he would turn the dinner knives away from looking at him, he said, as they lay on the kitchen table. He would throw a sweatshirt over those knobs that used to lock the car door from the inside. And once he dismantled a chandelier in the middle of the night when everyone was sleeping. We found the pile of sharp and shining crystals in the upstairs hall. So you understand, it was terrible. When they clamped his one eye open and put the needle in and up through his cheek and into his eye from underneath, and left it there for a full minute before they drew it slowly out once a week for many weeks. He learned to lean into it, to settle down, he said. And still the eye went dead, ulcerated, breaking up green in his head as the other eye, still blue and wide open, looked and looked at the clock. My brother promised me he wouldn't die after our father died. He shook my hand on a train going home one Christmas and gave me 5 years. As clearly as he promised he'd be home for breakfast when I watched him walk into that New York City autumn night. By 9, I promise. And he did come back. And 5 years later, he promised 5 years more. So much for the brave pride of premonition. The worry that won't let it happen. You know, he said, I always knew I would die young. And then I got sober and I thought, okay, I'm not. I'm going to see 30 and live to be an old man. And now it turns out that I am going to die. Isn't that funny? One day it happens. What you have feared all your life, the unendurably specific, the exact thing, no matter what you say or do. This is what my brother said. Here, sit closer to the bed so I can see you. We were talking today about a woman in the gospel, the woman who thinks, if I just touch the hem of his garment, I'll be healed. And this poem's called The Star Market. And I'll tell you a secret. This is the Star Market in Porter Square in Cambridge, long ago. Is that Star Market still there?
Yes.
It's probably a Trader Joe's or something, isn't it? It's still a Star Market. That's reassuring, somehow. The people Jesus loved were shopping at the Star Market yesterday. An old lead-colored man standing next to me at the checkout breathed so heavily I had to step back a few steps. Even after his bags were packed, he still stood, breathing hard and hawking into his hand. The feeble, the lame, I could hardly look at them. Shuffling through the aisles, they smelled of decay, as if the star market had declared a day off for the able-bodied, and I had wandered in with the rest of them. Sour milk, bad meat, looking for cereal and spring water. Jesus must have been a saint, I said to myself, looking for my lost car in the parking lot later, stumbling among the people who would have been lowered into rooms by ropes, who would have crept out of caves or crawled from the corners of public baths on their hands and knees, begging for mercy. If I touch only the hem of his garment, one woman thought, could I bear the look on his face when he wheels around? We were talking earlier about how difficult it is to sit still. You know what I mean? Just sitting alone in a room quietly, without checking your phone, without doing anything, but just sitting there. So this is a prayer. It's called prayer, and it's really about that desire to sit still, and also the desire and the fear of writing. Prayer. Every day I want to speak with you. And every day something more important calls for my attention. The drugstore, the beauty products, the luggage I need to buy for the trip. Even now I can hardly sit here among the falling piles of paper and clothing, the garbage trucks outside already screeching and banging. The mystics say, you are as close as my own breath. Why do I flee from you? My days and nights pour through me like complaints and become a story I forgot to tell. Help me. Even as I write these words, I am planning to rise from the chair as soon as I finish this sentence. In the middle of this book is a series of poems written in the voice of Mary, the mother of Jesus. Not the Virgin Mary, though, and not the Mary that I grew up with, but the Mary who is still a young woman, not a mother yet. Meister Eckhart, the great theologian of the 13th and 14th century, said a wonderful thing about Mary. He said, perhaps Jesus is the fruit of Mary's enlightenment. That's what I'm talking about, right? Perhaps Jesus is the fruit of Mary's enlightenment. What a radical thing to say. He also said, each of us can become the mother of God. She was not the mother of God when she's speaking here. She is someone who is bewildered, who is spiritually searching, who sometimes glimpses something. Sometimes the moon sat in the well at night, and when I stirred it with a stick, it broke. If I kept stirring, it swirled like white water, as if water were light and the stick a wand that made the light follow, then slow into water again, unwobbling until the wind moved it. And I thought of all the moons, floating in the wells and rivers, spilling over rocks where the water broke. Moons in the sheep water, in the chicken water, or here or there an oar bent it, or a woman spread out her skirt and let it pool there. The light, I mean, not the moon in a circle, not the moon itself, but the light that fell from it. Once or twice or three times, I saw something rise from the dust in the yard like the soul of the dust, or from the field, the soul body of the field, rise and hover like a veil in the sun billowing, as if I could see the wind itself. I thought I did it, but I didn't. as if the edges of things blurred, so what was in bled out, breathed up and mingled, bush and cow, dust and well, breathed a field I walked through waist high, as through high grass or water, my fingers swirling through it, or it through me. I saw it. It was thing and spirit, both. The real world, evident, invisible. How you can't move moonlight, you have to go there and stand in it. How you can't coax it from your bed to come and shine there, you can't carry it in a bucket or cup it in your hands to drink. Wind won't blow it. A bird flying through it won't tear it. You can't sell it or buy it or save it or earn it or own it, erase it or block it from shining on the mule's bristly back, dog's snout, duck bill, cricket, toad. Shallow underwater, stones gleam underwater. And the man who has just broken the neck of his child, he's standing by the window, moonlight pouring on his face and throat. You think this happened only once and long ago? Think of a summer night and someone talking across the water, maybe someone you loved in a boat, and you could hear the oars dripping from half a lake away, and they were far and close at once. You didn't need to touch them or call to them or talk about it later. The sky, it was what you breathed, the lake sky that fell as rain. I have been like you, filled with worry, and then relief. You know, the wind, it's sky moving. It happens all the time. And this last poem of Mary's is when she's trying to talk about the Annunciation, when the angel came to be with her. Even if I don't see it again, nor ever feel it, I know it is. And that if once it hailed me, it ever does. And so it is myself I want to turn in that direction, not as towards a place, but it was a tilting within myself. As one turns a mirror to flash the light to where it isn't, I was blinded like that and swam in what shone at me, only able to endure it by being no one. And so specifically myself, I thought I'd die from being loved like that. I want to just read a few poems from this new book, which is called Magdalene. It's in the voice of, I guess, Mary Magdalene, only, again, she's not Mary Magdalene, the historic Mary Magdalene, about whom we know very little. But she's in, I think, she's the Magdalene who is in every woman, the woman who is the subject of her own life, who is, wondering about the meaning of her life, and who contends with what we all contend with. So the mythic character comes in and out of these poems, but often the speaker is very contemporary. Some of these I haven't read. This is called Before the Beginning. Was I ever virgin? Did someone touch me before I could speak? No blood when it finally happened, no pain. Who had me before I knew I was an I? So that I wanted that touch, again and again, without knowing why or who or from whence it came. How the story started. I was driven toward desire by desire, believing that the fulfillment of that desire was an end. There was no end. Others might have looked into the future and seen a shape inside the coming years, a house, a child, a man who might be a help. I saw his back bent over what he was working on, the back of his neck, how he stood in his sneakers and wanted to eat him. How could I see another person? I mean, who he was, apart from me, apart from that. Here's a poem called Thorns. It's a fragment found inside Magdalene as a girl. Thorns. I pressed them through my hair onto my head, pressed them into my waistband and later into my palms. A secret intimacy among those thorns and me, a love from who or to whom it mattered less than that it was. And that it was the evidence of love, and so a comfort in the small pain they brought. Here's a poem called The Affliction. When I walked across a room, I saw myself walking as if I were someone else. When I picked up a fork, when I pulled off a dress, as if I were in a movie. It's what I thought you saw when you looked at me. So when I looked at you, I didn't see you. I saw the me I thought you saw, as if I were someone else. I called that outside, watching. Well, I didn't call it anything when it happened all the time. But one morning, after I'd stopped taking all those pills, standing in the kitchen for 1 second, I was inside looking out. Then I popped back outside again and saw myself looking. Would it happen again? It did, a few days later. My friend Wendy was pulling on her winter coat by the kitchen door, and suddenly I was inside and I saw her. I looked out from my own eyes and I saw her eyes, blue, gray, transparent, and inside them, Wendy herself. Then I was outside again. And Wendy was saying, bye-bye, see you soon, as if nothing had happened. She hadn't noticed. She hadn't known that I'd been there for maybe 40 seconds and that then I was gone. She hadn't noticed that I hadn't been there for months, years, the entire time she'd known me. I needn't have been embarrassed to have been there for those seconds. She had not noticed the difference. This happened on and off for weeks. And then I was looking at my old friend John, and suddenly I was in, and I saw him. And this was almost unbearable, he saw me see him. And I saw him see me. He says something like, you're going to be okay now, or it's been difficult, hasn't it? But what he said mattered only a little. We met in our mutual gaze, a third place I'd not yet been. This is Mary Magdalene on men, their bodies. One penis was very large and thick. So when he put it inside me, I really did say, wow. One penis was uncircumcised, and I loved to grip the shaft and pull it down so the head popped out like a little man. One penis was curved, so I had to move in a different way. One penis was so friendly, I was never afraid of it. One penis was so slender, I was startled. One penis was blunt and short like a pig. One penis couldn't harden until he stuffed it inside me. One penis came as soon as I started to move. "I'm so sorry," he said, "I have a problem." But I didn't care. I loved that boy. One penis pressed against me hard almost every morning, but I got out of bed as if I hadn't heard a word it had said. One penis was so dear to me, I kissed it and kissed it, even after I knew it had been with someone else. One penis I never saw, but my hand came to know it from the outside of his jeans. One penis loved the inside of my mouth so much it sang, it sputtered. One had a name. One was a mouse. One, he explained to me, had very, very tiny crabs, so we couldn't have sex for a while. One was orthodox and wouldn't touch blood. One had a mole, a hard little dot just under the rim. One penis was extremely patient without making a big deal about it. One penis had a great sense of humor. One penis had herpes, but I didn't know that word yet. One was a battering ram. One was a drunk, staggering, a lout, a bully. One slept inside me, comfortably at home. There are a number of quotes from the Gospel of Thomas quote, scattered through this book, and one of them is, his disciples said to him, "When will you be visible to us, and when will we see you?" And he said, "When you undress and are not ashamed." This is a poem called Magdalene and the Seven Devils. We were joking earlier about John 9. I got to meet with this amazing group of brilliant women earlier today, and I'm still a little drunk from it, spiritually drunk. This is Magdalene, the Seven Devils. In Luke chapter 8, verse 2, Mary Magdalene is referred to as Mary called Magdalene, from whom seven devils had been cast out. So this is a poem where she speaks about those seven devils. Magdalene, the Seven Devils. The first was that I was very busy. The second, I was different from you. Whatever happened to you could not happen to me, not like that. The third, I worried. The fourth, envy, disguised as compassion. The fifth was that I refused to consider the quality of life of the aphid. The aphid disgusted me, but I couldn't stop thinking about it. The mosquito too, its face, and the ant, its bifurcated body. Okay, the first was that I was so busy. The second, that I might make the wrong choice because I had decided to take that plane that day, that flight before noon, so as to arrive early, and I shouldn't have wanted that. The third was that if I walked past a certain place on the street, the house would blow up. The fourth was that I was made of guts and blood with a thin layer of skin lightly thrown over the whole thing. The fifth was that the dead seemed more alive to me than the living. The sixth, if I touched my right arm, I had to touch my left arm. And if I touched the left arm a little harder than I'd first touched the right, then I had to retouch the left and then touch the right again, so it would be even. The seventh, I knew I was breathing the expelled breath of everything that was alive, and I couldn't stand it. I wanted a sieve, a mask, a cheesecloth to breathe through that would trap it, whatever was inside everyone else that entered me when I breathed in. No, that was the first one. The second was that I was so busy, I had no time. How had this happened? How had our lives gotten like this? The third was that I couldn't eat food if I really saw it, distinct or separate from me, in a bowl or on a plate. Okay. The first was that I could never get to the end of the list. The second was that the laundry was never finally done. The third was that no one knew me, although they thought they did, and that if people thought of me as little as I thought of them, then what was love? The fourth was that I didn't belong to anyone. I wouldn't allow myself to belong to anyone. The fifth was that I knew none of us could ever know what we didn't know. The sixth was that I projected onto others what I myself was feeling. The seventh was the way my mother looked when she was dying, the sound she made, her mouth wrenched to the right and cupped open so as to take in as much air, the gurgling sound, so loud we had to speak louder to hear each other over it, and then I couldn't stop hearing it. Years later, grocery shopping, crossing the street. No, not the sound. It was her body's hunger. Finally evident, what our mother had hidden all her life. For months, I dreamt of knuckle bones and roots, the slabs of sidewalk pushed up like crooked teeth by what grew underneath. The underneath, that was the first devil. It was always with me. And then I didn't think that you, if I told you, would understand any of this. So let's end right there, okay? Thank you.
One of the things that you and I were kind of talking about right when you came in was you made a distinction between the divine and God. And I'd like to maybe hear you or maybe discuss that concept or those two concepts and how they're different to you.
Well, Khaled said, where are you? Where is he? He left. Where is he?
He went outside to take care of some.
He went out to smoke.
Some business. Yeah, right. He's having some business out there.
He said Theo. He said Theo is God. Remember Theopoetics? Did you hear him say that?
Yeah.
And I said, Theo's not God. Is Theo God? I said to David, and he said, yeah, it's God. And I said, really? What? Because I'm ignorant. I said, what language? And he said, Greek. I said, it means God? Theo?
Yep.
And I said, oh. And he said, what? And I said, I just don't think of it as God. I mean, God has become an unfortunate word. It's a word we have to resuscitate, right? Because it's become a word we can actually say. Whatever it is that we're talking about, there should be some word that we don't say beyond. I mean, there should be. So I just said, I think of it as the divine, maybe. But even the divine's a problem, isn't it? Because it sets up a difference.
It would definitely be a problem for theologians, I would imagine.
Yeah.
Poets probably are like, yeah, whatever.
No, don't you dare say that. Poets would say, yeah, whatever.
Well, no, to God, we'd be like, yeah, that makes sense, divine God. We're in the same way. Like, the theologian would probably parse
Excuse
that.
Me.
Yeah. No?
Who is the person who brought up the problem with the word? A poet. I am arguing with
that's
you.
Right, that's
a poet
right.
Care most about accuracy, deeply about accuracy.
Right. I agree.
You were joking, right?
Yeah, I'm teasing you.
Okay,
yeah.
Good.
Right. No, but you know, and that's an interesting part too about I've heard you write about it, I've heard you talk about specificity of language.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember reading about an exercise you did with students where you had them, I think it was for about 2 weeks, write only things they saw.
Yeah, we were talking about this today. They do it every week for
every
the whole
week?
Year.
For yeah. A whole year. Oh, wow. Okay. So what's the purpose? What's the hope of that exercise? Rather than trying to get them to couple it to something deeper.
Well, it's assuming something deeper is deeper. Right? Which I do not assume. Right? So that whatever is actually here is holy, is here. But also, it's just becoming, first in a very rudimentary way, it's becoming awake to what's actually in front of us. Mm. Most of us spend our time in our minds, right? Thinking about the future, thinking, regretting the past, worrying about the future. We live in our heads and we walk by things, everything. I do. We walk around and we don't see, we don't perceive. We don't actually feel the chair. We don't see the light, the rainbow in your water. We don't You know, it doesn't even have to be anything beautiful. It's just what actually is. So just to begin with what actually is, or what we can perceive. Of course, now we know that what actually is, we can't even see 90% of it, given dark matter and dark energy, right? And do you also know, well, you probably know this, microbes that we cannot see, we're really mostly microbes, we're not even us. We're a whole we're something else. Like 80% of us are microbes, invisible to us. Anyway, back to the visible world. I love the visible world. And just to begin to apprehend it, I was telling these guys a story. One of my students came in and said, I hate these observations, they're stupid. And also they're hard to do because people want to say what they think instead of what they see. And I said, just go outside and just walk, stand up right now, walk outside and come back in and tell me what you see. And she went out, she came back, she said, nothing, I saw a puddle. I said, nothing? You saw a puddle, what's in the puddle? She said, well, actually, there was a piece of paper in it. And I said, what's on the piece of paper? She said, I don't know. I said, walk back out and see what's on the piece of paper. She walked back out, she came, she said, some philosophy paper, somebody dropped it. I said, what's in the paper? She walked back out, she came back in, she said, existentialism and the meaning of life. Right in the puddle.
But to think if you hadn't been making her write those things down, she would have never.
Oh, no, and I wouldn't have the story to tell. Such a great story, right?
So you mentioned this too while you were reading. You talked about kind of writing away from yourself, and I've also heard you talk about your fear of writing before, that it's a fearful experience to sit at the desk, like you were saying in that one poem. And there's also a sense to which I've read things that you said or heard things that you said where you talk about the poem finding you.
Mm-hmm.
And I wonder how those two things are correlated for you. Is there a connection between the silence and you sitting, just
they're
peacefully
deeply
observing?
Yeah, well, we had this experience today. You know, Laurel, we were doing automatic, just writing, just quick writing, and how to whenever we sit down and we don't know what's going to happen and we begin to write, we're going to be changed, you know. You know that feeling of not wanting to be changed? Sometimes it's a hot day and someone says, let's go swimming, but you don't want to be changed, even though you like to swim. But you go in the water, you come out, you're different. Do you know what I'm talking about? Well, writing is that deeply, right? So when you begin to write, you don't know what's going to happen, and anything can happen. And also, you know, you write into the unknown, you have to be ready to be changed. It's not always easy. And of course, often you don't. You just write around in circles, and you sort of stew in your own self, which is also painful.
Is that change the thing that you fear?
What do you mean? I'm sorry.
Well, the fear that comes from writing. I guess it may be the idea that fear.
It's the approach, really.
Okay.
It's the approach, you know. I don't know if you guys feel this way, but does anybody else walk away from what brings you joy? What is that phenomena? I mean, that phenomena. That not doing what brings me the deepest joy. There are people nodding, right? What is that about, do you think? And that's part of it too. I mean, what you know, I do the grocery shopping, I do the darn emails, I teach, I love teaching, but you know, I do all the stuff I'm supposed to do, but the stuff I really, that means so much to me, I often put off to the very last thing. Or if I really love it, I go in the other way. Or somebody writes me and I really like them, I've just met them, I don't even answer the email. You know what I'm talking about? Is there anybody here who knows what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you. I need your company because that thing, what is that thing? Someone just wrote me an email and said, your email, she wrote, said, I'm sorry it's been 2 months since I haven't responded to your letter, but your letter meant so much to me I couldn't answer it. I wrote back and I said, I know exactly what you mean. What is that? That has to do with the fear of what? The divine, joy, life, being here. It's all connected, right? Being seen, being recognized, having a connection. Something. It's very interesting to me. I don't understand the phenomena.
Well, yeah, that you would resist something that seems so naturally wonderful.
Do you?
Oh, I think so. Yeah. I think sometimes it's not just fear, but it's a sense to which, you know, we live in this fast-paced, breakneck speed life where we're connected to everything, and then we go home, and you sit with your kids, or mm-hmm. you sit with your spouse or your partner, mm-hmm. and you just eat.
Or you read a book. It feels so good.
Right, but we've been trained to see purpose in everything, mm-hmm. right? So maybe the absence or feeling that we don't see that purpose in the thing that we're currently in front of is a source of fear.
It's crazy too, but speaking of theology and poetry, you know, Keats said that poetry needed happy indolence. Mm. Happy indolence. And prayer needs that too, right? You need to just surrender. You need to have that indolence, that kind of just receptivity, instead of like rushing. How could anything happen when we're so single-minded, going doing our tasks.
Right. That kind of dovetails nicely to another thought I had while you were reading about, you'd mentioned John being your spiritual
one of them. Mm-hmm.
Mentor, a person who helped guide you. And he was younger than you.
Yeah, he died at 28.
That's always interesting, right, the idea of a person who's both gone but also younger being someone who's a mentor, right? Because we think of mentors as older people who are living.
I don't.
You don't?
No.
Well, maybe better.
Because of Johnny, right? I mean, right. Since he was a little kid, he was just this beautiful, wise kid. My daughter's taught, had been a teacher to me, and she's 16 now. But, you know, I feel like he just had this, he could see into reality in a way. You know, he got sober at 23. My family was riddled with alcoholism. Everybody in my family is alcoholic or addicted to something. And Johnny was the first one to go into the rooms. And so he really led the way, you know. I was saying to these guys today, he was 28 years old. He was 90 pounds by that time. You know, AIDS, the wasting of AIDS back in the day, you know, it was terrible. Couldn't walk. His eye was exploded in his head. And he said, "This is not a tragedy. I am a happy man." He was something.
I wonder if maybe, too, the facing of that fear you were talking about, the needle in his eye,
mm-hmm.
the facing of that fear helped him reckon that and have closed his...
I think getting sober did. You know, you said to me, "Oh, thank God I'm sober. Thank God I'm a sober alcoholic. What if I had thought I had to do something, if I had to fight AIDS?" You know, I mean, surrender was the great liberation of his life.
Mm.
Forgive me, John, if I'm misspeaking, but I feel I don't mean to say something so sure about someone else's life.
Right.
But I have a feeling that he might use that word, that surrender.
Who are some other spiritual mentors that you have, past, present, younger, older, living?
I love Meister Eckhart.
Yeah.
I love Simone Weil. I love Thomas Merton, late Thomas Merton.
That's Seven Story Mountain's a tough one, yeah.
Yeah, he's a young man. But all the women and men, the poets, I mean, there was a group of women poets who have meant so much to me, all poets, I mean, but Lucille Clifton, Brenda Hillman, Emily Dickinson, Jean Valentine, Jane Kenyon, so many of the women I know are interested in meaning and the, you know, the integration of the spiritual, the political, the physical, the erotic, all of it together. And this is the thrilling nature of this conference, I think, too, that the imagination, the body, and the theological don't have to be divided up anymore. This is promising. Right?
We're doing our best.
Yeah. Promising. And women really have led the way to that. I think of feminist theology, feminist, you know, theory is leading the way, opening all that up.
Someone wanted to clap for that, I think.
Yeah, definitely.
Clap it up, yo.
Yeah, I mean, it's true.
Those people are companions to you. And you mentioned poems of companionship as well. Do you have any poems of companionship that stick out? Do you have any memorized things like that?
The poem I think of, it reminds me of your question about the observations too, is a tiny poem by Galway Connell. Anybody here know the poet Galway Connell? Galway Connell was one of the great poets who just died a couple of years ago. Beautiful man. And he has a little poem called Prayer. And it goes like this. Whatever happens, whatever what is what I want. Only that, but that.
Can you say it again?
Prayer. Whatever happens, whatever what is what I want. Only that, but that. There's a beautiful writer named Alex Lemon. He's a poet. You know Alex Lemon?
I know his work. I don't know him.
And he was very, very sick with a brain tumor for a long time. He was immobile. And he tattooed poems all over his body. His whole body is covered with poems. And on his back, he has that poem of Galway's. And I was actually present in the parking lot in Provincetown, Massachusetts, when Galway Connell met Alex Lemon. And Alex Lemon said, Galway Connell, look at this. And he took his shirt off, and Galway looked at the poem. Whatever happens, whatever what is what I want. But Alex left out one of the is's. There's three is's, right? So Galway went, oh, you've forgotten one of the is's. And it was a sort of wonderful, terrible moment. Because there's three of them in a row, right? Whatever what is what I want. And Alex said, whatever what is what I want. Not the same thing. Such a wonderful guy, both wonderful guys. I love that little poem. I say that poem 100 times a day.
That's what they're for.
Yeah, like a little prayer.
Wonderful. One more question, then maybe we'll open it to other people who might have one. I've been really interested in sort of the deepening of the exploration of the carnal in your work over time, and hearing some of the poems you read tonight, mm-hmm. I think is a real culmination of that deepening.
Mm-hmm.
And I wonder if you might talk a little bit about writing about sex and spirituality, and also writing about kind of the essential nature of the spiritual as it encounters the physical. How do those two things interact with your work, and how do you see them kind of opening over time?
I have no idea. I was hoping you would speak to that. I mean, I feel like this is the great wound we have to heal, right? The great wound. And of course, women are still being punished for this wound. Even as we sit here, women are being raped and beaten to death because of what they represent in certain cultures and to certain people and to patriarchy. So sexuality and spirituality do not have to be at odds. And this, I don't know, I'm very interested in just writing into the difficulty. I don't know how to heal it, but I feel as if there are people who are beginning to think of healing it, you know. The erotic, of course, is much larger than just sexuality. Audre Lorde has a great essay on that. Do you know that essay, you guys?
Yes.
So everybody who doesn't know it, you should just Google it. It'll pop right up. It's like two pages, right? What is the erotic? What's the uses of the erotic? What's the title? Something like the use of the erotic is power. Audre Lorde, one of the great, great, great poets, woman of color, powerful woman, great friend to Audrey and Rich, you know, just one of the women who kicked open the door, the beginning of feminism, and of deep feminism. I mean, the feminism that liberates us all, you know, which of course is also deeply connected to the earth. What we do to the earth, we rape the earth, we rape women, we murder the earth. So this is all connected to Eros. What real Eros is, you know, is the creative force in life, you know. It's not merely sexuality. So it seems that we've been, Eros is it's like the, sort of like the thing we were talking about earlier. We're afraid of it because it's so powerful, the way we're afraid of love, you know.
It was the mystery.
Yeah, and just the power, the transforming power of it. So I would love to hear what anybody has to say about that question. The no more binaries. No more this or that.
You had said in the beginning when you were asked for starting your comments, you're talking about the distinction between divine and God, and one of the phrases, a couple phrases I heard you say was, these words need to be resuscitated. And also a little further on, you'd said, we need to find a way to allow for things to be unsaid, which I thought was really lovely as well. So maybe, you know, I'm just asking you to speak more about those two things and how that works in poetry and in writing, really. So.
Mm-hmm. I learned a course with my students last year at Sarah Lawrence. We did a year-long course on eco-poetics. And we began to talk about language. We said, what do we call everything else? Or what do we call, like, what we used to call nature? Because we are nature. Well, or then that turned into the environment. Right? Which isn't this, what's the environment? Like, when we were trying to understand what words to use to when referring to everything that is. And we finally just said everything that is. We couldn't, because these words deadened the absolute vitality of what we were trying to describe. The environment, for example.
Very sterile word.
Sterile, yeah. Awful, ugly word.
Especially compared to nature.
But nature, the problem with nature is that we don't often include ourselves in it. Mm-hmm. We say we have a relationship with nature instead of it's us. We're a part of nature too. We are nature. We are animal. We are connected. We're not connected even assumes a separation. That's what I mean. We have to find new words, new syntax. To try and achieve a new vision of the non-binary way of apprehending our experience, so that I guess that's what you were speaking to, and I'm on the edge of it too. I don't know how except to keep trying to. Like the word God, I don't believe in God. Well, neither do I. You know, what's God? I mean. It doesn't mean anything anymore. It can't mean whatever this is going on in this is, right? How can we even approach the power that is animating the universe and all the universes that might be? How do we even say it? How can we must choose another word. We must find another way of describing it that honors the unspeakable vast energy of it, you know? Whatever it is. I mean, God is something you can actually hold, no. I don't know what that, all, you know, I don't know what to do except to say, we have to do it.
Can it be one word?
Well, that's nice, right? Like that. Yeah.
Hi.
Hi.
I kind of have a follow-up question to that. Thinking about creating new words. Once we find a word to kind of express the inexpressible, after a while it seems like that word too might not do justice. So do you think perhaps poetry kind of serves as that like creative imaginative way of like enlivening
sure.
language?
Yeah. Well, how many words did Shakespeare create? Like, does anybody know the answer to that?
Hundreds.
Yeah, yes, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds.
Could have been other people, too.
What?
I said allegedly. Could have been other people. You might have had some help. It might have not just been Shakespeare.
Well, even, you know, so that we can keep creating words, I think that would be great, you know? Yeah. Whatever makes things undead. And alive, awake to us again, you know, so we feel the reality of it. I mean, that's what art is trying to do, right? It wakes us up. What did Kafka say? It takes an axe to the frozen sea within us. Bang.
I like that you just described it as whatever wakes us up from being undead, right? That's powerful.
This is intriguing to me. So understanding creating words as a constructivistic act.
Yeah.
And then understanding that perhaps looking more at the Eastern Orthodox traditions, we have this idea that theology comes from an emanation. It's a discovering process of things that are already there. If we're talking about constructing something, constructing language about Earth, are we starting from the wrong place? Should we try and find what is already there and create a theological discovery within our poetry?
Well, is it really already there? Knowing what we know about the nature, perception, and reality, I don't know that it's already there. I don't know what is.
We only know where we can start.
Where we can start.
So I'm not convinced that beginning with the construction of new language for these terms.
So I'm just trying to follow you. So where would you start?
I'd probably start with Pseudo-Dionysius's Holy Quiet and wait for God to speak to us. Some of these words may not fully encapsulate, sure, but perhaps we can look at language as something that initially is used to understand themes and concepts we create, and then we reject that creation. And the inevitable goal is to enter into a holy, quiet presence with God.
That's your inevitable goal. You mean the inevitable goal is to be in holy quiet with God.
Forgive me for my lack of specificity. So I didn't mean any the. I was never trying to create a sort of axiomatic statement or some sort of meta-narrative that goes for everyone. I was just saying there seems to be alternative roles, and I'm not convinced of the veracity of that the that was presented.
No, I'm very interested in what you're saying. I'm not exactly sure, and it's my awkwardness. I'm not quite sure I'm following you, and I want to follow you. Is anybody else following? Can you help? Me? Come on. Help me. The place to start is what I think I'm...
If you're going to create a language, right, how are you going to teach it? There's going to have to be a reference to an earlier manifestation of the thing you're trying to express, right? So I think what he's saying is that there's a technique somebody can use.
It seems like what he's saying is that there's a technique. I'm not familiar with the specifics of the tradition he's talking about, but there's a technique called holy quiet. It must have been written about by Pseudo-Dionysius, an ancient writer. So apparently this is a place where you will come to a kind of quiet, and the language, the first language that you're supposed to begin with, will proceed from contact with God. Pass it around.
We couldn't do this on Twitter. I mean, we could, it would just be awful.
One of the things about Pseudo-Dionysius is that he follows the last stage is the via eminentia, or the via of excess. And it is at that stage, after that stage, that you are in silence. And what is interesting about that is that you have exhausted all language. You have used all possible names for God that there are. Not that you have not said any, not that you have been quiet about it, but that you have exhausted all of them, all possible names, from the greatest to the least. And so once that happens, then there is silence, because there's no more to say.
Surrender.
Yes.
But that's just God. What about nature? Same thing, we have to exhaust every word for isness. Right. Hi.
I loved your statement. I was raised Christian. I also love Midrash. I guess two questions. Why do you like Midrash? And do you understand your poetry as a kind of Christian Midrash? I mean, I see a lot of the poems you read tonight as kind of filling out some of the gaps in the gospel text. Is that how you understand it?
Well, that's a lovely way to put it. I wouldn't say filling out, because the way I understand some of these stories is not conventional. But God and the imagination are one. The Torah is a living text. So these stories, of course, are living stories. We created them, and we can imagine into them. So I love imagining, you know, way back. They are the architecture of my inner life. I grew up with these stories. When I was the oldest of 9 children, we would put on these Christmas plays, you know. But I'm very interested in the stories as, to use my friend's, a starting point. What does it mean to be the mother of God? You know, what does it mean to be, you know, Thomas? What does it mean to be, you know, Peter? You know, the fuck up. Excuse me. I love him.
They really just remind him a lot about things, don't they? Yeah.
One of my favorite stories is when Peter denies, after he denies Jesus those 3 times. And then when Jesus has come back from the dead and they're all having dinner together, and Jesus turns to Peter and says, "Peter, do you love me?" And he says, "Yeah, you know I do." And he asks him 3 times, "Peter, do you love me?" "You know I do, you know I do." "Do you love me?" "You know I do." And it's such a beautiful, lovely thing to let just in friendship, you know, to let him say it 3 times to undo the other thing. Just a simple thing like that. It's nothing more, nothing less, just that. So beautiful. I don't know. But I love the Midrash. I love that for them it's not a sideline, you know, that the imagination is an act of divine imagination. That, you know, while Stephen said God and the imagination are one, William Blake said the imagination is God. So that God, there's that word again. But that, you know, that the imagination is actually an organ that through which divinity can perceive itself, the world, whatever, where it's breaking down. So I love, do you know a writer named Aviva Zornberg?
A bit, yeah.
Do you guys know about Aviva Zornberg? Aviva Zornberg is like the Beatles. She is extraordinary writer who does Midrash now. She's written a book called The Beginning of Desire about the book of Genesis. A close reading of the book of Genesis, every little story. And then she's written her next book, and The Beginning of Desire comes from a Wallace Stevens poem. And the second book is called The Particulars of Rapture, about close reading of Exodus. And then she has a book called The Murmuring Deep. And if you could ever go and hear her speak, she's extraordinary. She comes at it through the language, through the original Hebrew. But wow. She does a reading of the Abraham and Isaac story that is so radical. It's psychoanalytic, really, reading of it as the repetition compulsion. It's really extraordinary. Beautiful.
Thanks. One more?
before we wrap up.
Can you just say the name one more time of that author?
Aviva, A-V-I-V-A-H, Zornberg, Z-O-R-N-B-E-R-G. She used to teach, what's it called when you teach different kinds of language literature? What's it called?
Comparative
literature, thank you. I know, it's getting bad. I say things like, can you hand me that thing that you put water in? Like, comparative literature. But now, she was raised by a rabbi father and studied with him an hour a day for her whole life. And she holds these classes in her living room in Jerusalem. Let's go.
I'm Marie. I'm the last question. And I'm a student at Westfield State University in English. Anyway, I was interested in the story you told about your student telling them to go out and look at things. I assume that the sort of purpose of that is that maybe they'll see something divine sort of in the things that they look at.
No.
You shake your head?
Well, I don't mean to interrupt you. You finish your sentence.
Well, it's going to go on a little bit, so if you could clarify, maybe it'd help me.
There's a great essay by the writer John Berger. Do you know who John Berger is?
No.
He's an art critic, I guess, but he's also a novelist and a poet. He's a brilliant, brilliant man, and he lives in the Italian Alps, French Alps, and he's 90 years old, and he rides a motorcycle, and he's a remarkable man. And he's written many, many novels and poems and essays. And the original book in the 60s that changed everybody's life was called Ways of Seeing, Ways of Looking at Art. But he has a beautiful essay called Notes Toward a Small Theory of the Visible. And he talks about the kingdom of heaven and how the kingdom of heaven might be as close as a salt shaker on your table or as one of the apples Cézanne painted, you know? That it's right there. It's not that the divine, you're looking for the divine, you're looking for what's actually there. And it might be that that is the divine, but you're not looking for anything special. That's why I just wanted to make that point.
I understand. So,
thank
but
you.
We you'll admit that maybe something sort of, if you're asking a student to do this, you're kind of hoping something special will happen for the student. I mean, what would be the purpose of asking them to do it?
I want you to do this with me for 1 month. 1 month. Write 10 observations a week, and by the end of 4 weeks, you will have an answer. Because when someone writes about the rusted gutter and the water pouring through it onto the muddy grass, the real pours into the room, and it's thrilling. And we're all enlivened by it. We don't have to find more than the rusted gutter and the muddy grass and the pouring cold water, you know? And that it takes months sometimes for me the young students, to finally realize that they're not looking for the sublime.
Okay, so that realization is the special thing, right?
That's
what I'm saying. Like, there's an in.
You keep wanting something to be special.
Well, I just need to get to my question. My question is, you said about your brother that he had this way of seeing into reality. Now, you talk about, I'm asking about, do you think that there's a difference between seeing reality and seeing into reality? And it seems like one of the things that we're dealing with at this conference, I don't know because I just got here like everybody else, but one of the things we're trying to do is sort of cleanse the doors of perception and be able to talk about things in a new way that brings it up for people, kind of, you know, Heidegger said language calls things in the presence.
Right, right.
We're trying to find a way to talk about things in a way that calls them in the presence in an adequate way. What I'm wondering is, you know, it seems like what gets in the way of that is when people have preconceptions of things. Like, mm-hmm. It seems like I do, right? Like, if I have a preconceived idea of the holy, then I will go out and look for the holy in things and I will not see what's actually there.
Absolutely, yeah. Beautiful.
Right, but so my question is, how do you get somebody to sort of understand holiness without that idea of the holy? How do you get rid of your apparatus of ideas and then encounter the things that those things were trying to describe?
I understand your question. It's a beautiful, beautiful question. Thank you. You exhaust them.
It took a long time.
I exhaust them until finally they just give up and they begin to write about the leg of that metal chair and the gutter and the muddy grass, you know? They get exhausted, finally. I want to just finish by reading, this is a really short poem, just to represent my brother better, John, it's called The Gate. And in a way, it's speaking to what you're talking about. Thank you. I can never find anything. Here it is. Thank you. So it's brief. It's called The Gate. I had no idea that the gate I would step through to finally enter this world would be the space my brother's body made. He was taller than me, a young man, but grown himself by then, done at 28, having folded every sheet, rinsed every glass he would ever rinse under the cold and running water. "This is what you've been waiting for," he used to say to me. And I'd say, "What?" And he'd say, "This," holding up my cheese and mustard sandwich. And I'd say, "What?" And he'd say, "This," sort of looking around.
Thank you. Let's keep this clapping even louder now.
All summer, I don't want to be me. I don't want to be my father either. 11 years in his windowless office, adding and subtracting, wishing and forgetting he could be more.